Good evening. Can you hear me okay in the back?
Yes.
Hi, I'm Jack Rosenthal, the interim director of Roosevelt House, the public policy institute that President Senator Rabb has developed for Hunter. This was Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt's New York home for 25 years until they moved to a somewhat grander house on Pennsylvania Avenue in Washington. It's an apt place to discuss public policy. It was an FDR study upstairs that he and Francis Perkins developed Social Security, among other chords in the social safety net. Let me begin by offering you a test. Here are two quotations. Can you name their authors? For a while, it has been American doctrine that the government must not go into business in competition with private enterprise. Still, it has been traditional, particularly in Republican administrations, for business urgently to ask the government to put at its disposal all kinds of government assistance. Now, here's the second quote. There's little wonder that Americans of the right and the left, and many in the middle, are apoplectic at their government and absolutely and rightly convinced that the game of government is rigged in favor of the elite and the powerful. The first voice is that of FDR in his famous Commonwealth Club speech in 1932. The second is the voice of our speaker tonight, the angry voice of Gary Hart in his new book, The Republic of Conscience. There's probably no one in America better qualified to express anger about Washington. Gary Hart is principled. In the 1984 campaign, though pressed for funds, he refused to take PAC money. Small wonder that Barry Goldwater once said, "You can disagree with him politically, but I have never met a man who is more honest and more moral." Beyond honest, he's educated. Not content with a Yale Divinity degree, he went on to get a Yale Law degree. And then, 35 years later, earned an Oxford PhD. He's the author of 21 books, including 5 novels. Beyond educated, he is, of course, politically experienced. He started his career as a Justice Department lawyer, invented the Iowa caucus for the McGovern campaign, served with distinction in the Senate, and, of course, was himself a formidable candidate for president. Beyond being experienced, he's wise. To cite just one example, he co-chaired the Hart-Rudman Commission, which well before 9/11 predicted terrorist attacks on America. And his take on Washington is not limited to anger. In this book, he offers a thoughtful program for how to turn the present Republic of Corruption into a true Republic of Conscience. Please join me in welcoming Gary Hart.
Thank you very much. I am indebted and deeply appreciative of Mr. Rosenthal and all those at Roosevelt House and Hunter College for the opportunity to be here and the invitation to join you. And I thank all of you for taking the time out this evening to think about the current condition of our country and where we're headed. I was thinking about, and I mentioned in the book, a Rockwell painting called, I shouldn't raise this, well, I can't remember the name of it. It's the picture of a man in a public town meeting standing up, clearly a working person, and he's speaking and he's making his point of view known. And gatherings like this remind me of that very much, because that is what republics are all about. I've spent a lot of time in the last few days wondering what the founders of this country would think if they were to return and see what has become of what they created. And it is clear that to a person, to a man, mostly men, they would be astounded by the technology and the advanced lifestyle of two-thirds of us anyway, and all the changes that have gone on, staggering changes from their time in the late 18th century. But based on 20 or 25 years of reading and research and graduate studies about the history of the Republic dating from ancient Athens through Rome and up to the American Republic created in the late 18th century by those founders, it is crystal clear that they would conclude that the government they created is massively corrupt. And that is the argument I make in this book. There are lots of books now on money and politics. And I think of that array of books, this one, if it has any unique quality, it is the fact that it is based in the theory of the Republic that our founders believed in. And that theory, according to the historian, noted early American historian Gordon Wood, was that the basic principles of the Republic had to be constantly renewed if you were to maintain the integrity of that political system. And what were those founding principles? First and foremost, and this is true of all republics throughout history, all the true republics, popular sovereignty, no king, no monarch, no oligarchy, no ruling families. The power in that republic belongs to the people. I think the Black Panthers discovered this back in the 60s, power to the people. The second quality was what they called civic virtue. Today we would call it citizen participation. They felt it was absolutely necessary if the country and the government they were creating was to survive, that citizens participate in government. They'd undoubtedly be appalled that we are promoting democracy throughout the world and routinely half of us don't even vote, even in national elections. So there is a gap between what we proclaim and what we actually do. Civic virtue. You protected and earned your rights, your democratic rights, by performance of your duties. And your duties were more than reluctantly paying taxes and occasionally signing up for the military. Your duties were to participate in the public life of the Republic at all levels, national, state, local. A third important quality was a sense of the commonwealth, a sense of the common good. It's all the things we own together, and they're considerable, particularly for someone in the West. That includes natural resources, timber, all kinds of recreation categories that we have throughout the country, transportation systems, water systems, air and water quality, and the list goes on. That's the Commonwealth. And they insisted that that republic maintain that sense of the Commonwealth. Now, we're going through a period now where it's one of those trends in American history that Arthur Schlesinger used to write about so eloquently, of leave me alone. Anti-government, focus on the individual, focus on the corporate interest, focus on commerce and the economy, and otherwise leave me alone. And indeed, the other side of that coin is privatization. Why do we have all these things that we own in common? Let's privatize them. Let's sell them or give them away so that private enterprise can operate them or extract the resources in the mountain areas that are used for parks and recreation, wildlife, and all the rest. Closely allied with those three other qualities, popular sovereignty, sense of the commonwealth, was the quality of resistance to corruption. Now, if you were step outside this hall and stop citizens on the street and say, how would you define corruption? They say quid pro quo, bribery, giving some money to a politician who gives you something that you want. That's not what the founders had in mind, and that's not what the classic ideal of the Republic defined as that kind of corruption. It was placing narrow, special, or personal interests ahead of the common good. Placing special, narrow, or personal interest ahead of the common good. Now, if you pay attention at all to the last 30 or 40 years in Washington, or participate as I had the opportunity to, you have to believe that that is what largely our government has become. Now, why is that? We have always had lobbyists. We have always had people who came to meet with their elected representatives and say, my company needs this, or my town needs this, or my state needs this, whatever the entity was, and I hope you'll vote for it. There's nothing wrong with that. It's not illegal. It's sanctioned. It's permitted. What has changed, and it's changed since the time that I was first elected, the 1970s, is the growth of that lobbying industry explosively. It is now an industry that spends or consumes $4 billion a year. That's a lot of money. In a Congress of 535 people, just calculate that out as to how much per person that is. But it also is a connection of that explosive growth of lobbying money to campaign, to the explosive growth of campaign contributions and costs. You've heard enough politicians to know that we all tell personal stories to illustrate a point. I can tell you my story that illustrates the point. I ran for office the first time as for the United States Senate in 1974. There was an incumbent, two-term wealthy incumbent, Republican. We had six people in the Democratic primary. I was fortunate enough to succeed in getting the Democratic nomination and then defeating the incumbent. The entire campaign cost $375,000. Average contribution, $17. Now, that was admittedly a long time ago. I didn't have white hair at that time. 6 years later, I was running for re-election. I raised and spent just over $1 million, three times what it had cost 6 years before. I retired at the end of the second term, and a congressman named Tim Worth replaced me in the Senate. Tim spent $4.5 million. That would have been in 86, and then did not run for a second term. Mark Udall, a Democratic senator from Colorado, ran last year was defeated, but raised and spent over $25 million. So there it is, I think. And this is a state of 5 million people. It's not New York. It's not California. It's not Texas. It's a human scale state. But it went from $375,000 to well over $25 million. Mark's opponent spent a lot more than that, and the so-called super PACs spent more than that on his behalf. That's in just one active lifetime, that span of that, 40-some years, whatever it was. This is replicated all across the country. We're now talking about $1 to $2.5 billion presidential campaigns. So the question is, where does that money come from? And is it connected to those special interests? And the short answer is yes, of course. We have, I get to tell you another anecdote that I think is, for me at least personally, was the tipping point. As far back as 1979, a group of Coloradans came in. They were brought out, I can't remember what their interest was, but they were there in a legitimate purpose. They needed help, rural electrification or something of that sort. And their Washington representative of their organization brought them in. And on the way out the door, according to my administrative assistant, they left a plain white envelope, and he brought it in to me. So I opened it up, and it was a check for $2,000 for my reelection campaign the next year. So I told, he said, what should I do with it? I said, run down the hall and give it back to them. I don't want anyone in my state, or anywhere else for that matter, thinking they have to leave money to see me. For that matter, they don't have to come to Washington because I was in the state all the time. So that began, that day, in my mind at least, began an awful trend. And part of that trend also was in that first Senate I served in the 70s, some of you may recall, in this state, Jack Javits, across the river, Clifford Case, Mac Mathias, Chuck Percy, all very good moderate Republicans that one could work with, but also the Mike Mansfields and the Stuart Symingtons and the Abe Ribicoffs, the Gaylord Nelsons and the McGoverns and the Muskies, and the list goes on. Not one of those people ever became a lobbyist after serving in the Senate. There may have been some House members, but not very many. Now there are over 400 former members of Congress who are registered lobbyists. That does not include their spouses, their children, their staffs, their committee staffs, and their network of contacts. What they took out of office that was valuable was a Rolodex, a network of contacts in the Congress and in administrations, and the ability to have access to those decision makers and those policy makers. So when all this began in the late 70s, build up in the 80s, and then began to explode in the years thereafter, you had this confluence, interconnection between this exploding lobbying industry and campaign financing and the congealing, if you will, of a power system in Washington that increasingly shuts the rest of us out. I wouldn't have a chance to run for office today. I don't have enough money. People say, well, wait a minute, what about all those people running on the Republican side? Not all of them are wealthy. Well, we've been hearing excessively in the last 24, 48 hours about a local businessman. You know who I'm talking about. He's self-financing. There are some others there. One of them comes from a very famous family, a member of which, has been on a national ballot, somebody told me, for the last 7 elections. I don't know. I haven't counted them up, but you can figure it out. But then what about the others that are not personally wealthy? They're either not from a famous family connected, or they are not personally wealthy. Well, there's been something the press has been calling separate primaries, and the separate primaries are named after very rich people. One of them's a casino magnate. He has his own primary, and he picks a candidate, and he finances that candidate. And there's a man in Florida who's supporting one of the candidates. He's also a billionaire. There are a couple of brothers from Kansas I've heard about. They pick a candidate and support that candidate, or maybe one or two, a little like betting on a racehorse. So that's what we've come to. And the net effect of that is to shut out new thinking, new leadership, people who are not part of that network. And that is a corrupt system, according, not to me, but according to the founders of our country. So all of this is to say, if they were to come back today, if they believe what they said and what they wrote, and these were scholars of the ancient republic of Greece and Rome, they read, many of them, Latin, classical Latin and classical Greek. They read the thinkers, the great early Republican thinkers in both societies, in the original language. They knew what they were doing. They knew what they were talking about. And the ideal of the Republic was brought back to them in the Scottish and English Enlightenment. And that's where these foundational ideas came from. You not only have to create that foundation, but as Gordon Wood quotes some of the early thinkers, those principles have to be routinely renewed. They can't just be left there. What that means is citizens, those of us who have the power, who have the sovereignty, must insist on integrity in our government. Now, that, I know that sounds a little old-fashioned, but it's not going to work unless we restore that integrity and respect for office. How can anyone seek election to the House of Representatives, Senate of the United States, governorship or whatever, serve for a period of time, make a lot of wealthy friends, and then go out and make more money influencing the people they served with? That's called monetization. It's monetization of a title that was given to you by the voters of your state. To me, that's as unethical as anything you could do. And it was the same for those great senators that I served with in the 70s and most of the 80s, before things really began to get out of hand. So what I'm pleading for tonight and in the book and hereafter is that we focus on what I learned in eighth grade civics in a public school in Kansas a long, long time ago. What it means to be a citizen, what it means, what popular sovereignty means, what integrity in office and in politics means, and restore that. I think people ask for specific reforms, and I don't list a whole lot of them here. But what if an elected official who is either defeated or retired has to wait a year or 5 years or 20 years before they can cash in and make money? That's one thing that could happen. Not much chance this Congress is going to pass that law, but they should. There ought to be limits on campaign financing. Instead, to compound the tragedy, the highest court in this land has legalized this corruption. How could any Supreme Court justice believe that any of these founders intended for a legal fiction called a corporation to have the same First Amendment rights of speech as you and I do? How can any person with a law degree, let alone selected to the Supreme Court, believe that's what the founders intended. It's beyond me. The decision has to be reversed. It means the Supreme Court has to be changed. We can pass campaign finance reforms. If you talk to individual members of Congress, they will tell you, as they have told me, I was elected to a six-year term, a senator says. In my first year, I have to spend 2 hours a day outside my office at the Democratic or Republican campaign finance party headquarters, because one of the last things that's illegal in Washington is to raise money from your office. Thank God. So they walk across the street to the party headquarters and make phone calls to people asking for money. 2 hours a day, 6 years. Now, how many people of thoughtfulness and integrity, even if they love this country and love even more being in the Senate, are going to put themselves through that, in addition to all else that goes with holding office these days? It's a scandal. We talk about scandal, and the press defines that as peeking in somebody's window. My son John, who's with me, pointed out today the 10th black church in America was set on fire last night. That's a scandal. That's a scandal. What does it take to put a deputy sheriff on the steps of a black church in America to prevent it from being burned down? Old people without medicine is a scandal. Children without food is a scandal. So, and the corruption of our government is a massive scandal. So all this book tries to do is root what is palpable in the American public, the sense of unease, frustration, sometimes anger, sometimes even hostility, and loss of confidence in their own government. Call the attention of those people to the fact it doesn't have to be that way and demand change. I think it will happen. The only question is whether it's going to take another Watergate or another scandal of that kind to force those we elect and to force ourselves to rise up and change this system. You've begun by being here tonight, and I appreciate it. Thank you all very much. I also told those who organized our event that when my hair turned white, I lost my hearing. So I'm gonna do. Who was that talk show guy that invented coming into the audience? Bill Donahue, yes. Yes, please go ahead. Here we go.
Yes, I really enjoyed your comments, and I do thank you for using your time and your effort to be speaking about such crucial, crucial issues. My dilemma is this. I am totally sick to death of the corruption that is taking place, and you see it on a micro level and you see it on a macro level. It's everywhere, and I am disgusted by it. Now we have an election coming up, and my initial instinct was to go for a Hillary Clinton, not just because I'm a woman and I would like to see in my lifetime a woman president. I have to make sure that this is the properly credentialed person and the right person for the right time. Having spoken to some people recently, and I'm not, you know, I'm an independent, but I have since become aware of Mr. Bernie Sanders in Vermont. And while I can honestly say to you, I have not vetted every single person that's out there, certainly I'm not even looking at the 14 Republicans, but on the Democratic side. But what I do know of Mr. Sanders, which I believe is what we need at this time, is I think he has an uncorruptible, if that is possible, in the White House. But as much as it is possible, I believe that he is an uncorruptible politician. And when I speak to this about, I speak to people about this, about working for him, about voting for him. The question is, am I throwing away my vote if I vote for Bernie Sanders? But wait, people, okay, don't laugh. Keep an open mind, everybody. No, don't be so opinionated. Well, they will get to speak, okay? They will get to speak. Is it, I'm just saying, I think he's an answer potentially, but I know he has a snowball's chance in hell in winning. So what do we do? I believe Hillary, as wonderful as she is invested with Wall Street, and I don't want any more.
I don't think any vote cast for somebody you believe in is a wasted vote. The real question will come once the party, whatever both parties choose a candidate, then you decide and don't waste that vote. But in the process of selecting a candidate or a nominee of a party, no votes are wasted. Just vote, participate.
Have you considered whether it's possible that you're over-idealizing the good old days? If you were to go back to the post-colonial period, the early founding period, the only people that could vote were moneyed white males, no women, no minorities. You probably had less than 5% of the population that actually could vote. You had, for example, Cornelius Vanderbilt said, the only good politician is, an honest politician is one who once bought, stays bought. Senators and representatives were bought on the floor of the Senate and of the House with cash. So are we really that much worse off now than we were in those days?
The history of America and American politics is, as I said, Professor Schlesinger established, cyclical. I'll come back to you soon. We go through waves of what he called reform and consolidation. We would call it, consolidation was stop making changes, and then when you stop making changes, things went to hell, and then you had to have reforms, and then those reforms were relaxed, and you went through that cycle again. Every 30 years, he said. He got that theory from his father, and his argument is pretty plausible if you look at the history. No, I'm not saying that we're in worse shape today than we've ever been. And this is not a gloom and doom book. In fact, I point out exactly what you said. There have been ways that this country is much better than it was. We've made some real progress since the day that you're talking about. It wasn't just rich white males, it was property. So you could have a farm and you got to vote even if your farm wasn't doing very well, but that's a separate issue. So we've made progress in inclusion, equality for women, civil rights for minorities, particularly African Americans. If we would help if we could quit burning their church down. And young people, the process today is much more inclusive than it was in the 50s and 60s, let alone in the, and we've had scandals, Teapot Dome. I mean, you could spend all night here talking about scandals in government. Watergate was one, more about power than money, but also a little bit of both. And we make progress, we make enormous progress in many ways, but we still fall into these periods. Now, what I'm idealizing is that Senate that I served in the 70s, where no one, well, I shouldn't say no one, I can't remember one senator in either party that walked out the door and became a lobbyist. They simply wouldn't do it. You can't imagine, if any of you remember Abe Ribicoff, he was too dignified, he was too much of a statesman to cash in his Senate title for money. That's what it's about. Yes, I'm sorry. Then.
So I've always thought that campaign finance reform is so critically important to spearheading other reforms and restoring some integrity to government. But the question is, how do you get that created when the people who need to vote on it and make it happen are the ones who are benefiting from the system as it now stands?
It's called building an airplane in flight. Believe it or not, there is a power greater than money, and that's public pressure. If an elected official whose ambition is to be reelected, or who wants to be elected in the first place, gets a sense of an angry constituency or a frustrated constituency that will not, that simply says, are you or are you not taking PAC money in your campaign? That's a simple question. And you can make your decision based on that. We were reminded, I think I was the first national candidate to refuse to take PAC money. I ended up with a deficit, and it was not pleasant. But you have to stand on principle sometime. Simple question. Ask Mr. Bush, ask Ms. Clinton, ask anybody, are you or are you not taking special interest money? Be interesting. Mr. Sanders, I gather, as Senator Sanders has said no. That's important to know. So what would really cause trouble in this country if people gave up? We can't give up, because then they win. Yes, ma'am.
What are the concrete steps that we can take to overturn Citizens United?
Concrete steps, I mentioned several. Put a time ban on how soon you can go from office into lobbying.
No, I'm talking about Citizens United.
Oh, Citizens United. Well, you can try to amend the Constitution to overturn a Supreme Court decision, but it's not going to work. It's better to overturn the Supreme Court. I don't mean that literally. Change the Supreme Court. The history of Supreme Court opinions in this country is quite replete with total 180-degree reversals of earlier opinions on slavery, on a whole raft of things. Supreme Court one day, one decade will say this is the law of the land, and 20 years later or 50 years later, a Supreme Court said, no, we were wrong back then. It wasn't we individually, but we, the court, was wrong back then, and we're now reversing that decision. And we've seen some of that in recent times. So it's frustrating because it is going to take a while. And by the way, talk about wasted votes. When the time comes between two candidates, think about the Supreme Court. Yes, sir.
How do you deal with the issue of Congress when you have particularly the House of Representatives are seemingly running constantly for re-election, and then the people who and then the people who are behind the congressman are saying wonderful things about my congressman, and everybody feels they're perpetuating basically the same thing over again. So how would you address those issues? Because everybody seems to say, oh, my congressman's great, so they re-voted, and we end up with basically the same pattern over and over again, and the same congressman constantly running for re-election every 2 years, and so they're basically there on a re-election campaign.
Well, it's one of the more interesting and complicated facts of American political life that people will, everyday Americans will say, those bums in Washington are all bad, and vote for the incumbent in their own district. So it's a bit of the frailty of human nature that we think it's everybody else's fault. I remember, to invoke a New Yorker, when people talk about compromise, there were a lot of student groups I talked to back in my day who had the impression from reading recent American history that every day you voted on a profile and courage vote, that you had to decide either to vote for your career or to do what was right. And they just wondered how you make those kind of decisions. Well, actually, of all the votes you cast, maybe one in 50 or 100 is re-election versus integrity. But they will routinely say, all those people, how do you deal with all those people in Washington? Well, the first thing you say is every one of them was elected by a majority of the voters in their states or districts. So is the problem in the politicians or is it in ourselves? And there is that tendency, basic human nature, to think it's all those other people and not my elected representative. But I started to tell a story. I would, back in the 70s, we didn't have the budget issues we have now, but it was the beginning of the we can't go on like this attitude. And what Coloradans wanted me to do was to vote against everybody else's projects and then get them to vote for mine. We build water projects in Colorado. And the people in Colorado so understand the importance of those water projects because of the nature of our state that they thought I could just stand up on the floor of the Senate and talk about the importance of water in Colorado and everybody in the Senate would vote for it because it made such sense. And then I voted against everything important to them. I used Pat Moynihan. I said, okay, in my town hall meetings, you want me to get Pat Moynihan to vote for water projects in Colorado. He's from New York. What does he care? So Pat Moynihan comes to me, or I go to Pat Moynihan and I said, Pat, I need your vote on these water projects. He will say to me, we need money to rebuild the barracks at Port Drum. They're falling apart. So I'll help you out with the water projects, but I need your help with the barracks at Port Drum. I'd ask my Colorado constituents, should I say no? So there is that as well. They want it's just basic human nature. Our projects are important. Nobody else's. They're all wasteful everywhere else. Our congressman is good. All the rest of them are bad. I don't know how you change that.
I'm a member of the press, sort of. I'm a travel writer and did some stories on Telluride, Colorado last year at a beautiful resort called Denton Hot Springs. Can you hear me now? Is this better?
Better.
Okay. How do you think the press is doing? Is it helping? Is the press like...
Are you serious?
A watch? Yeah. What do you think?
Is that a serious question?
Yes, yes.
Well, you're asking the wrong guy. It's a kind of inside joke, so I don't know. We're not gonna... Well, again, I'm gonna make the same mistake I made earlier of the good old days. I said on one of the 100 talk shows today that I go back to, actually it was with John Siegenthaler at Al Jazeera, I knew his father, and he asked a similar question, and I said, look, I'm old enough that I go back to Walter Cronkite and Huntley and Brinkley and Scotty Reston and Tom Wicker, and those were journalists. Those were serious journalists. And they didn't write trash. They wrote serious stuff. And so as you contrast the politicians of today in terms of size and scale with those that I'm talking about 30 or 40 years ago, you can do the same with journalists. The rewards, at least in the era of tabloid journalism, of cable, rewards are for sensationalism. And they consider, too many of them, not just the reporters, but the producers and the owners, they're all driven by audience. You make your money with the size of the audience, and they say people don't care about what fracking is doing to the environment or how to defeat ISIS. These are too complicated, but they can understand personal scandal. So that's what we're going to give them. And that's where a lot of journalism, not all of it, but a lot of it has gone. Great newspapers are failing, in case you hadn't noticed. Brian and I talked earlier about book publishing. Five newspapers left in America that review books. Five newspapers in America review books. So you just state the facts and you can reach your own conclusion. I think I try to resist ad hominem comments, but I'll make an ad hominem comment. If you look for a date when things began to change in journalism, it was I would put it at the date that Rupert Murdoch appeared on our shores. But that's all I'm going to say about that. Yes.
Do you think the United States is ready for a woman president?
Yes. Why not? My side has had its turn. Sure, absolutely. It's not a gender issue anymore.
At a policy level, we have sometimes been able to get cities to do what states and the nation won't. I've worked on climate change, and much of the initiative in this country on climate change has come from the cities. You're talking about that's a policy, although it involves a lot of process. You've been describing a process. Do you think there is any leverage in working on the kinds of processes that you are promoting or advising? Is there any leverage in the cities, or is it too small a forum to matter?
Is there any leverage in the
in working in the cities?
In the cities
on the kinds of policies that you or practices that you want to see promoted.
You know, I went back to school 15 years ago and got a graduate degree, earned a graduate degree, and wrote about that very topic and used Thomas Jefferson. And Jefferson, late in life, after he had been president, resumed his correspondence with John Adams. That's remarkable. And as usual, with hosts of other people. It's been estimated, I'll get this wrong, that he wrote 75,000 letters. I don't know whether that's true or not. Anyway, he said to Adams, he was in Paris when the Constitution was adopted, so he was not involved. He was sending letters every 6 months by ship telling him what to do, typically, and you can imagine how much impact that had. Anyway, he said to Adams, we missed a point when we put this whole thing together. What we should have built into the system, I don't know that he went so far as to say the Constitution, was what he called the ward or elementary republic. What I'm talking about this in this book, not just on a national scale or even on a state scale, but in the local community. And he thought, his point relates to what I said earlier, citizens find it difficult to participate in national affairs because it's far away, it's too big. Oscar Wilde said about socialism, too many evenings. And citizens feel helpless. So he said we ought to institutionalize, I guess today what we call either neighborhood or community government, and let people make decisions at that level to the degree they can. Well, I could talk all night about this, whether it makes any sense in the 21st century or not, but he was trying to address the very problem you're talking about at the sub-city level. I think great reforms, certainly in the challenges of people, housing, employment, education, a whole lot of transportation, a whole lot of the best ideas in this country have come from individual cities or communities or experiments.
Minimum wage.
And in an institution like this, we could name quite a few. What the key is to have a system that encourages experimentation. Now, it's a hallmark of the Republican Party to say that, and I think they're right. I think, but not at the expense of solving national problems. You can experiment all day while more and more people fall into poverty. So experimentation, trying new things, new approaches, new financial mechanisms, new ways of education, we ought to always be doing that. We should never, almost never, accept the status quo in methodology. So that's what cities can do, and even small local communities. One or two more. Yes, sir.
President Obama.
I can get it, and I'll repeat it. Okay.
President Obama can't run for re-election. If he were to call Senator Hart and say to him, as a practical matter, Senator, what should I do in the next 2 years to further some of the causes you've been espousing in your book that could possibly be effective and accomplish something? What would you tell him?
Next question. Well, you can't answer a question like that off the top of your head, but I will do so. He said one time, or somebody around him said early on, that he wanted to, I don't know how they phrased it, it was something like he would rather be bold one-term president than a mediocre two-term president. And up until recent times, there were a lot of Democrats and others who thought that he had kind of compromised on that theory. And in that short period of time between 1984 and 88, when I thought I might have a chance, I was coming up with some pretty bold things that would have set the agenda. What presidents can do is not wait for the constant bickering in Congress to come up with legislation or no legislation and then try to intervene. You've always got to be ahead of those 535 people and initiating new things and setting the agenda and making them debate your ideas rather than you responding to their ideas, which are few and far between. So I would say, certainly climate change, any initiative, working with Pope Francis on the morality of climate change, he can introduce legislation, very little of it's going to get passed. That's why he's turned to the executive order so much in recent years, just frustration at not getting a resolution one way or the other on so many things. Let me think real quickly. One of the most troublesome problems is going to be shaping a long-term strategy for dealing with ISIS. He can work with the military in doing that. It's going to take a lot more imagination than is being used right now, because it's a tough, tough problem. What he can do is set and train changes, reforms, that force the next president to, in effect, either stop what he initiated or carry on. And that's what, if I were in his shoes, that's what I would look for. Three or four things, not 10 or 12. Three or four things that if you started right now and changed institutions and changed policies and changed strategies would almost force your successor to either cancel what you've started, and that's quite often difficult to do if it's really underway, or to continue it. And the climate is one. Guns. I said earlier to one of the interviewers that I've thought a lot about the worst moments of my life, and one was John Kennedy's assassination, another was Robert Kennedy's, but most recently was Newtown, Connecticut. That's the worst thing I can imagine. 6-year-olds being killed in America. We with assault weapons. Something has to be done. Now, how you're going to defeat the NRA on something like this is a very, very tough problem. But I would just say, in his case, and he's made the point several times, but I think he's just going to have to keep after it. Gun owners can own hunting weapons or whatever they want. They don't need assault weapons. And they must keep them out of the hands of desperately troubled 18, 19, 20-year-olds. We've had two of these in Colorado, as you know. But there is something indescribable about the death of six-year-olds, violent death of six-year-olds in a public school. Last question.
Forgive me, it's not so much a question. I'm an educator, been in the business for 40-some-odd years. I don't know if there's any other educators sitting in the audience, but you've inspired me to go back. I'm a high school level, get my history teachers together, pull them together and say, let's go back and examine this, not in a cynical way, looking at government, but in a way that says, how do we precipitate change? And I can say, being in education for a long time, that if you start at that level, things will happen. I've seen it happen. My schools have done with environmental projects, for example. So thank you for that.
Well, thank you. I had in mind, had I been elected to national office, to have an annual dinner in White House for teachers and honor them symbolically, teachers from all states, and demonstrate the American people the critical role that teachers play. Too many Americans in the hubbub of life and changing nature of families and everything else just take public education for granted. Or if they're wealthy enough, they jump right out of the public education system. But it's, as Jefferson said, it's the backbone of democracy. You can't have democracy without broad-based, solid public education. And I'm doing all this stuff I said I'd never do about how good the old days were. When I went to a public school in a small town in Kansas in the 1940s and 50s, we had mandatory 2 years of Latin in a public school in Kansas. And these farm kids would study Latin and never ask a question. It had a huge impact on me in understanding how sentence structures work and words, where words come from. So it was embedded in my mind, and I didn't even think about it at the time, and no one asked a question. There was no protest at the school board meetings. Why are our kids studying Latin? We just studied Latin. We diagrammed sentences. And so I don't know anything about education theory. I know theories come and go and new things are tried and so forth and so on. But the strength of our public education system is critical to our future. And one of the things that ought to be studied is the principles upon which the founders based this country. Thank you all very much.